So I'll continue with transformations, and so like I said, these notes are available. So, and this is a crucial, slightly conceptual part of transformation. So please pay some attention. Okay. So what we see here is a box in space. Okay, and then I have aligned this xyz axis along three edges of the cube. Okay. The first step is to verify whether this is a right-handed coordinate system. Okay. It is. Okay, otherwise things will be in trouble. So always keep checking. I mean, not when you're solving problem, because in that case usually I would have taken care, but in real life. Very simple check, but please do that, otherwise things will go crazy. Now, as the box moves around, if I attach this coordinate system small x, small y, small z to the box, if I can describe how that coordinate system moves, then I have described how the box moves, right? Because I assume that the box is a non-compliant device. Otherwise, I'll have to write how the coordinate system moves plus write, solve a set of differential equations. Now, if I now ask you, what is the transformation describing this coordinate frame in this frame? Okay. Now we can, like I said, we can pretty much do this by inspection, right? Just simply by writing down the direction cosines of the various vectors. So you take the x vector here, it is directed opposite to the z direction. So I have 0, 0, minus 1. You take the y vector, that is directed opposite to the x vector. So it's minus 1, 0, 0, and then 0, 1, 0. And you just assume that the, well, the p which is here, the positions are px, py, pz, and 1. Okay. Straightforward. You can do this by inspection if it's visually doable, which is typical exam problems and which is atypical of real life problems. But anyway, let's say you can do that. So I have this object. Now I'm going to flip this about the y-axis so that this rotates and comes to the top. I get this configuration. Okay. Now you can associate with this, and you can pretty much write down this new transformation matrix. In this transformation matrix, so now along with this, the coordinate system x, y, and z has been reoriented such that now the z, local z axis is this way, local x axis this way, and since the rotation has been along the y direction, that axis is unchanged. Okay. So hopefully as I am doing this, you can note down what the, you can write down the transformation matrix by inspection again. Okay. So for example, the x axis is now aligned along the y axis. Okay. And the origin of the coordinate system is not changed at all. So this is px, py, pz, unchanged. Okay. Now, what is the action that I did? I rotated about the y axis by minus 90 degrees. Okay, because the box was originally like this, I went like this, which is a rotation opposite to the original y axis, local y axis. Now if I examine rotation about a y axis by 90 degrees, if you now evaluate it, you get this matrix, right? You had the formulas from the last class, 0, 0, minus 1. So now if I take the original T matrix and I multiply it by rotation of y minus 90 degrees, you will find out that you get T prime. Okay. Very interesting. That the transformation matrices, they can not only be, they are not only description of coordinate frames, they can be used to transform coordinates of points, and they can also be used to transform the full matrices. Okay. That's good mathematics, isn't it? That the same thing, same construct can give you three different kind of operations. Okay. So this is possible. This in itself is not interesting. The very interesting question is, I post multiplied the original transformation matrix by the rotation matrix. I could have pre-multiplied also, right? But if you pre-multiply, you get this matrix which is not T prime, right? It is some other matrix which I am calling T double prime. And we know already that pre-multiplying and post-multiplying are not identical operations, so they are not commutative, right? The question is, what is this matrix T double prime? Okay. So to look at it, you just carry out this exercise. I take this frame, capital X, capital Y, and capital Z, and I rotate this by 90 degrees about the Y axis, okay, not minus 90, by 90 degrees about the Y axis. So I get this frame where I get this as the X prime, capital X prime axis, this is the capital Z prime axis, the Y is the same as the Y prime axis because I am rotating around that. If I now describe the original box about this coordinate system, X prime, Y prime, Z prime, it turns out to be T double prime. Why do you think it happens? It's very weird, isn't it? Original was a rotation about the Y axis. So rotating about the Y axis is not unusual, but now I rotate by plus 90 instead of minus 90. I get a frame, and the description of the original box in this frame turns out to be T double prime, which is the pre-multiplication option. Okay. So to study this, what we will do is, we will now fix the box to this frame X prime, Y prime, Z prime, right, and we will rotate the whole thing so that this X prime, Y prime, Z prime becomes the same coordinate system as X, Y, Z. Okay, you get a sense of it? So if you do that, this is what happens. So essentially, we now take this frame X prime, Y prime, Z prime, and I rotate this by about the Y axis by minus 90 degrees. Okay. And when doing that, since I am rotating about the Y axis of minus 90, I take the box and attach it to this using a rigid link. Y axis minus 90 degrees, so the box goes from the back and comes around, comes all the way around here. So the position also changes, the orientation changes. Okay. So this frame, capital X prime, capital Y prime, capital Z prime, now becomes a frame capital X, Y, and Z, and the box has moved to a new position now. Okay. So now we get idea that T prime, now T prime was a description of the original box in the frame capital X prime, capital Y prime, capital Z prime. If I have rotated, connected the two together and rotated it together, then the description remains the same, except that now T double prime has become the same as, capital X prime, capital Y prime, capital Z prime has become the same as X, Y, Z. So T double prime is hence the description of the box after the box has been rotated by minus 90 degrees about the Y axis. Now, so what is the change? If you pre-multiply, you rotate about the base axis. When I post-multiplied, I rotated about the local axis. So this is the fundamental change. between the two. So both pre-multiplication and post-multiplication are valid transformation operations. One of them does it about the local axis, one of it does about the global axis. Okay. So we come to the summary of this. So if you post multiply a matrix representing a frame, okay, you can post multiply a frame, right? You can take a matrix representation of a frame and you post multiply by a transformation matrix. So the matrix that you get represents the frame obtained by carrying out transformations with respect to the frame A, which is the local frame. Now, pre-multiplication of a matrix with a transformation matrix results in a matrix. Now, which gives you the frame which is obtained by carrying transformation with respect to the frame in which the original transformation A was described. Okay? So, in simpler terms, we call it the base. But I am not calling it the base because, you know, you could, if you have many matrices and then you are going from here, 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 you could do this in any intermediate form. It is not necessary that you always go to the base. So, using this operation, you can do any intermediate form also. Base has a sense of being a fixed coordinate system to which many systems are referring to. So, this result is a little bit more general. Okay, so, you can use it quite the same. And then, after having done this, this is a word of warning. If you have done a course in computer graphics, or when you do a course in computer graphics, there are some changes. They also use similar transformation matrices. The changes are that they write their position vectors in rows instead of columns. Okay, number one. And the reason why they do it is because computer vectors originate from a computer, so it is easier to write a thing in a row, right? On the other hand, robotics has first come out for pieces of paper and then gone into computers, right? First you do derivation, so it is easier for us to write in columns, right? Our pages are short, so if you write a row, it goes like this, if you write a column, it goes like this, historical. Now, when you do graphics, so if you use row representation of the point instead of a column representation, then the pre and post multiplications get reversed out. So you need to be careful about that. Okay. And so corresponding changes are there. And also this pre and post multiplication, one of them is called a object transformation and one of them is called a camera transformation. Okay. So one of them is like you change the camera. So the object is same. So you can look at it from here and you look at it from here. Okay. So this is like our pre-multiplication option, and the other one is called object transformation, where you have the object here, so you just change the object. Okay, the camera is in the same location. So in graphics they use this term. So if you see these two terms, especially, I mean, if you are seeing papers written by electrical engineers who have a, basically a lot of them come from a vision background, you will see these terms being interchanged. So fundamentally we come to the conclusion that there is post and pre-multiplication, and they will transform, in our case, post-multiplication about the local coordinate system, pre about the base coordinate system, but the result is a little bit more general. So if you have concatenated transformations, you can do it about any intermediate one with appropriate description. Okay. Is this reasonably clear? Okay, so I will also try to upload a homework, all of them, you know, is try. If I am unable to do it, I will send mail to the group saying where I put things, okay, where you can download them from. So which will give you some practice sheets on this. Okay, so any questions? Smart class, huh? I understand everything. So, now we will get back to business of robotics. Now the reason why we did transformations is that we want to be able to transform from one axis, which is attached to a link on the robot, the DH parameters and associated coordinate system, to the next one. Okay. So this is what we do now. So we start with by first setting the arrow options. Okay. So I have this coordinate system which is there, which is xi minus 1 and zi minus 1. Okay, this coordinate system is there. And I want to go to this coordinate system which is xi, zi. Okay. So how do we go there? Now, since we are coming from the base, we assume that we already have a representation for the I minus 1 coordinate system with respect to the base coordinate system. Okay. So then, locally about the z axis, I want to translate by the amount di. If I do that, then this coordinate system will move over the z axis, it will become xa, za. Okay. So, ai minus 1 0 multiplied by the translation matrix 0 0 di represents the frame xa, za. Right. And again, note the post multiplication because I am moving about a local coordinate system. Next, I have this coordinate system, I am going to spin about the za axis, which is the local axis, by the amount theta I. So multiply by rotation about the z axis by theta I. Okay. Now note, each of these matrices is actually quite simple. This matrix is quite simple, this matrix is quite simple. And then after I have done that, I want to translate by the amount ai along the local x axis. So I add translation ai 0 0 and finally I obtain the frame xi yi by rotating about the xi axis by the amount alpha. Okay. So this is the description of the frame xi zi. So four successive transformations, and we know that we cannot reverse them, right? You cannot write them in any order. We have moved in a certain order, we have got to write it in that order. So we call this matrix translation matrix 0 0 di, rotation matrix z about theta I about z, the translation matrix ai about the x axis followed by rotation about the x axis by alpha I. We call this matrix a I with respect to I minus 1. Okay. And this matrix is a 4 by 4 matrix obviously and is in this form. Pretty reasonable matrix, not very large, not very small, okay, one of them. So if you use, so if you know the Denevit and Hartenberg parameters, okay, then you can pretty much write down this matrix. What will be the values? Now out of this, theta I and di can be variables, ai and alpha I are usually constants unless you have flexible manipulators. Then you can have more fun. We will not have it in this course. Okay, and this is called the joint transformation matrix. There is some changes. Some people will write it as, you know, I minus 1, A, I here. Some people write it as I minus 1, I, depending on the notation which is being followed. So there is nothing sacrosanct about it. You just, when you read a paper, just be careful about it. Or read a book, be careful about it as to which is the notation which is used. Okay. Now we talk about so-called special cases. Like I said, they are not really special. They are the common cases. So if you take the case 2 that we discussed with ai equal to 0 and alpha I equal to pi by 2, this matrix becomes beautifully simple, right? It's very simple. And it's very common to find it in this form. So we are looking at this case as case 2, right? For this, it simplifies into this form. And so it's very common in robotics to use terms like c theta 1 to represent cos theta 1, s theta i to represent sin theta i, v theta i for cosine theta theta I. And then the other common thing we'll get is terms like C1, 2, 3, right? And that stands for cosine of theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3. That also occurs quite often. Okay. So this is standard nomenclature. So you can have C1, 2, S1, 2, S1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Versine theta. You've forgotten your JE stuff. What is 1 minus cos theta? It's a good exercise. You should Google it. Okay. So, check it out, little bit, small bit of homework, okay. How many of you will Google it? No, right? You are going to be, if I ask you at the beginning of the next class on Tuesday, what is versine theta, you will be looking left, right, center to see who has found it out. Okay. Do a little bit of homework, just read it up. You know what is sec theta, right? Yes. Sec and cosec theta, you know. Okay. So, now that we have done the transformation from one coordinate system, one link coordinate system to the next link coordinate system, we can obviously march, right? So this is what we do, and we call this the forward kinematics problem, okay? Which is, you want to compute the end effector position and the orientation, okay? Given the joint variable values, so you're given all the joint variable values, so either thetas or the d's, right? And now you want to find out that if your manipulator goes into these values, or the each individual joint goes into these values, then where does the end effector go? Okay, that is the question which you want to address. Okay. So how do we do that? It's very simple. You know the DH parameters, you know the joint variable values, compute A10, A21, A32, A43, A54, A65, multiply them together, okay? If you are not worried about computer times, you can just use the code to multiply 4 by 4 matrices. If you are a little smart, you will realize that there is the 0001. So there is no point multiplying by these zeros, okay? So you can reduce the number of operations by writing your own code if you are a good programmer, okay? And there are some other simplifications also which are possible. So for that you have to know a little bit more, okay? You can actually separate out this rotation, the angular rotation and the translation, and then you can simplify it quite a bit, a little bit more. But the primary simplification you can do is at least stop multiplying, you know, don't do this row into all the other rows in the other side, knowing that these are all zeros, okay? At least avoid that operation when you're doing the computation. And especially when you're running them on micros and small computers, then these become important because you have to do it quite often, okay? So part of the problem in robotics lies there, you know, that there are some operations which you do very often and you have to write them precisely and very, very accurately and in a compact form. Otherwise, because if you do them too many times, it will add to the overhead. It's not like, you know, typing in Microsoft Word where you're kind of inputting a text, a character every half a second or quarter second. Things are happening. You're doing extensive computations, including evaluation of sign. How is sign evaluated? Inside a computer?
Truncated series.
What about inverse sign? series. Do you know the sign? Do you know the series for sine inverse? You can do a Taylor thing, right? What is the problem with Taylor thing?
It doesn't converge.
Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't, depending on the applications. So there are issues, right? So forward kinematics is anyway just sines and cosines. There are no inverse operations involved. But still it's an, you know, it's a Taylor series which has to be calculated. So it's not easy. So you need to save on computation, and you can understand how many sines and cosines. Even in the simple one, there are four of them, right? But then you can cheat, because once you evaluate C theta 1 in one case, you don't evaluate it the second time, right? You need to take that Taylor series expansion only once, and then if you evaluate C theta 1, you may not want to do a Taylor series expansion to find the root. There are faster methods to finding the roots. So these kind of, so you get, you know, now you can find a dedicated chip to do this kind of stuff. That's why you have graphics chips and graphic cards, which have do many of these things in hardware. Okay. So you multiply this matrix out, and if you are doing numbers, then it's all quite hunky-dory, okay? You just get 16 numbers with a row of zeros at the bottom, with a one here, some interesting things in the top half. But if instead of using numbers, you are doing this in a symbolic form, you want to retain cos theta 1, cos theta 2, alphas and d's, then typically each term in the final matrix of A60 will have how many? How many numbers? How many things concatenated? If you multiply two matrices, what will you get? You'll get cos theta 1 into cos theta 2 typically, or cos theta 1 into sin theta 2, and you'll get as many summations as you have number of rows or columns. So 4 summations, right? If you multiply again, then each term will typically have 3 things multiplied together, and how many summations? 16. If you have common terms, then you can club them together, okay? So it's 16. So if I multiply 6 of them, 24 sums, and each one containing 6, right? So you can try it out. It's a good example. You can just put in cos theta I, and then MATLAB has a symbolic toolkit. Have you used it ever? No? No? We'll have a look at it in the lab. So MATLAB has a symbolic toolkit. So you can define that this is symbolic, so it does not ask for a value for it. And then later on, after you've done everything, so most of your homeworks you could have done in MATLAB, even if someone says derive. So it will done it, and then you can ask it to simplify. You can ask it to pretty it so that it does all the factorization, clubs it together, gives you a nice expression. So MATLAB has a symbolic thing. There is a very nice thing called Mathematica, right, which is completely symbolic, and it's very expensive, and it has a lot of stuff in it. So it's good for doing research. So usually, even for industrial manipulators which have those nice simple matrices, even then the terms become quite complicated. So for example, if you look at this book, say for example by Fu, Gonzalez and Lee, there's a book called Robotics, Control and Vision. Okay. So I think they have derived it for the Puma 560, okay, the A60, and you will see if you look at some of the terms, they're very large. They run into 3 lines in the book. Okay, so just to give you an idea how complicated it is, but in this form it looks nice and compact, and you can evaluate it. Okay. So that's forward kinematics. So the next thing is, today we'll just discuss today just this slide as to what are we trying to do when we do inverse kinematics. Okay. So we know the joint angles from the encoder at the joint motors. So that's what the joint angle is. So using forward kinematics, we can compute location of the links and of the end effector, and we can then build graphics simulation. What kind of graphics simulations? Let me just flip through to it. So now you look carefully. So this matrix that we had, right, is essentially the end effector, the last is the A60 matrix. Okay. So here we're just calling it the EE, the end effector matrix. Okay. So as I change a joint angle, watch, the end effector matrix will keep changing, though I'm changing only one of them. Okay. So the change is complicated. And then now if you look the wrist, these four don't change because that's the bottom row, 0001. So what is interesting is, let's keep on tracking 3, 4, 2, 4 and 1, 4. Okay. So I'm moving the fifth one. Those are not changing. The orientation is changing. Okay. So when I move the wrist joints, it's only the orientation of the end effector is changing. So the 3x3 matrix, which was of this part, which was here, that changes, but the position is not changing. But if I change some of the base motors, then everything changes. Right? But when I change the base motor, the third row is not changing. Okay? The third column is not changing. Sorry, it's three all. The third row is not changing. Why is that? Yeah, the height is not changing and the orientation about the z-axis is not changing, over the global z-axis. Okay. So that's important. So if you want to build a simulation like this, okay, you essentially need only the forward kinematics and nothing else. Okay. And just to fill you in the details, how this simulation was built, a nice simulation like this. So you can go to a robot manufacturer site. They will usually give you what is called VRML, virtual reality markup language, description of each link, okay, which has everything inside there, including the joint axis, everything. So the geometry is there. You can import this, right? And then if you use any standard package, C# with OpenGL, it gives you tools to reposition these virtual reality, so these are solid objects, in space, using similar transformation matrices as we have done. Okay. So we just take them and we just program them to move around according to the transformation matrices we just derived. And so as per the DH parameter set of the robot. So then it behaves exactly like a robot would do and you can have nice fun with it. Okay. Or you can use it for serious research. Because that's what. So hopefully by the end of this course, you will actually be able to take a robot and be able to build a simulator like this. Okay. But this does not have any dynamics in it. We will also put in the dynamics. So we'll have lots of fun. Okay, so now to come back to the slide. Now what we have done so far does not allow us to actually work with a industrial manipulator. Now why is that? Because the task there is, suppose there is a peg and I want to place it in a hole, you will tell me, okay, there is a peg which is kept here, right? You have to pick it up and put it in a hole which is there. Now you know where the peg is kept in a world coordinate system, you know where the hole is in a world coordinate system. So you have to then take the manipulator, make it go with a specific orientation to a specific position, grip it, lift off, come here and insert it. So the description of the tasks is usually in some base or world coordinate system. It is not in the joint coordinate system. So now if I want the end effector coordinate, that means I want A60 to be of a particular kind, which is described by this position and this orientation, I have to work backwards and I should be able to figure out what should be the various joint angles at the motors. Because if I know that, then I can just tell the motor you go to that angle and I am assured that the end effector will go to the right configuration. So that is the problem which we want to solve, that so what should be the joint variable so that the end effector is at the desired point with the desired orientation. Okay. So this is the inverse kinematics problem that we want to work on, is determining the values of the joint variables given the position and orientation of the end effector. Okay. So this is the problem. So I will stop here today, because there is a sequence which I want to go through and needs at least a continued section to focus on that. So just think about it, and have you solved this kind of a problem before? That is the only thing which I leave you with. Inverse kinematics problem? No. So this is very similar to the 4 bar problem if you think about it carefully. Right. You are asking that if I want the output angle to be theta 4 to be a certain value, what should be theta 1, theta 2? Right. That is exactly an inverse kinematics problem. Okay. So we look at it, but in a 4 bar, because you close the loop, the forward and inverse kinematics problem are very similar. If you ask that, okay, if I give you theta 2, what is theta 4? That is equally tough problem as saying that if I want theta 4 to a certain value, what is theta 2? Because, you know, whether you go from left to right or right to left, it is the same problem. But the inverse kinematics problem in robotics is similar to the 4 bar problem. Okay. So with this, we will stop today. And take it forward, and so please look at your mail. I'll let you know whether where I've sent the files and the assignment. Okay. Yeah.
So like we have a 6-axis machine that is meant to hold something.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the world with respect to the world origin. We have the coordinates of the point where we want to reach.
Yes. No.
So there can be more than one motor angles for different.
Yes, lengths. Yes, there can be more than one motor angle for different lengths. That is, which is part of the problem. That's why I didn't want to start on this today. So we first have to look at a much more simpler case and hack it to death, so that we know everything that can happen in an inverse kinematics problem, and then we'll expand it using the matrices into the other problem. So the question that you are asking is even simpler, right? The answer to that. So even if you have a tooling manipulator like this, right, and I want the fingertip to go here, and if I don't want to specify the orientation, so I can do it this way or I can do it this way, right. I think in kinematics you called it the elbow up and the elbow down solution for the 4 bar, right. So there are 2 solutions which are possible. So if I am given this length and this link length for the same joint angle, I can either approach like this or I can approach like this. Two solutions are possible. So here there are 2. For the serial manipulator, maximum number you can have is 16. Okay. Fortunately for us, because we don't use the general manipulator and we use special cases with things orthogonal and things 90 degrees, usually it is down to 4. For a bad manipulator, 8 solutions. Okay. Again, they can be partitioned into elbow up, elbow down, right shoulder, left shoulder. Okay. The right shoulder is very interesting. If I want to point here, I can do it like this, right? Or I can do it like this, right? So the trunk rotation is allowed, right? So the right shoulder and the left shoulder problems. So solutions. So we'll see all of them. So it's something we need to worry about. That's why I didn't get started on it today, because I'll not get anywhere in the next 5-10 minutes. Okay. So have a good weekend.